Good morning. The first item of business is general questions. In order to get in as many members as possible, I'd appreciate short and succinct questions and responses. And at question number one, I call Bob Dorris.
To ask the Scottish Government, other than the Police Investigations Review Commissioner and Scottish Public Service Ombudsman, what mechanisms exist to support the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service to improve its practices, processes and its decision-making?
Solicitor General.
Presiding Officer, there is a strong culture of review and improvement within the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service. The Police Investigations and Review Commissioner investigates police incidents and does not have a role in relation to the work of COPFS. The Scottish Public Services Ombudsman may consider how complaints have been handled, but cannot review prosecutorial decisions. HM Inspectorate Prosecution provide an essential function in scrutinising practice and identifying potential for improvement through independent, evidence-based inspection. COPFS has a dedicated team which investigates complaints and enables victims to exercise their statutory right of review of certain prosecutorial decisions.
Bob Dorris.
I thank the Solicitor General for that answer. My constituent's daughter, Ms Webster, was charged with an offence by Police Scotland in 2016. It took 6 months for the prosecutor to identify that Ms Webster had informed the police at the time of the charge that exculpatory evidence was available. The further investigation which followed did not contact her nor her lawyer. Indeed, I was told by the Lord Advocate that would have been inappropriate. 2 years after that, the case was dropped within days of the exculpatory evidence being passed to the Crown Office. Can the Solicitor General not see that an independent review of this case, could help identify errors and improve practices, processes and decision-making? And given the Lord Advocate has so far declined, is there any other mechanism by which such a review could be secured?
Solicitor General.
I am aware of the case to which Mr Dorris makes reference. While it would be inappropriate to discuss details in Parliament today, the case to which he refers has been subject to extensive review and consideration by the law officers. COPFS keeps all decisions under review. Ultimately, in this case, when the exculpatory material was received, the original decision to proceed was reviewed, and following this, a decision was made to end the prosecution. Presiding Officer, I know that the Lord Advocate has already made an offer to meet with Mr Dorris and his constituent, and I would gladly renew that offer today.
Brief supplementary, Colleen McNeill.
Thank you. In a letter to me regarding the Horizon scandal, the Lord Advocate said that prosecutors could not and would not have raised proceedings on the basis of the Horizon evidence alone. And I'm aware that the Crown Office used an independent report presented to them by the Post Office prepared by forensic accountancy firm Second Sight as corroboration. The Director of Second Sight has said that its interim report revealed system flaws and problems with the prosecution process. So I'm keen to understand why the Crown Office was content to use this report as corroboration. I wonder if the Solicitor General could, at the very least, commit to write to me on that point, if she's not able to see today, why the Crown still proceeded to use that report as corroboration.
Solicitor General.
Presiding Officer, in a statement to Parliament in January, the Lord Advocate explained the position of COPFS as to its awareness of flaws in the Horizon system and its approach to prosecutions consequent upon that. In terms of our openness to scrutiny of all decisions, practices, processes, matters are progressing with the Scottish Criminal Cases Review Commission and also the Appeal Court. I'd also say that there's a public inquiry underway and the Crown has publicly committed to supporting all these processes. I would gladly write to Ms McNeill to take up the points that she's raised in greater detail.
Thank you. Question number two, Mark Griffin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, to ask the Scottish Government how it is working with North Lanarkshire Council to improve the school estate.
Cabinet Secretary Jenny Gilruth.
In Scotland, the school estate is owned and managed by local authorities. However, we have supported North Lanarkshire Council through the previous Schools for Scotland Schools for the Future programme by awarding the Council with significant funding of £55 million towards three new schools. We will further support North Lanarkshire Council's Cryston High School extension. That's through phase three of the £2 billion Learning Estate Investment Programme. The £2 billion Learning Estate Investment Programme is a joint programme with COSLA and follows on from the successful £1.8 billion investment in Scotland Schools for the Future programme, which delivered 170 new or refurbished learning facilities across Scotland from 2009 to 2021.
Griffin. I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. The Scottish Government has, though, cut capital funding for projects like schools in North Lanarkshire by 31% this year, excuse me, far higher than the cut received by government. The last new school project to receive money from the Scottish Government was back in 2014. And over the three phases of the funding programme the Cabinet Secretary talked about, North Lanarkshire only received funding for one existing secondary extension, despite presenting a number of excellent bids for much-needed new schools. So can I ask the Cabinet Secretary, when can pupils in North Lanarkshire expect to receive government funding for new build schools fit for modern education?
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank the member for his question. Of course, as I alluded to in my initial response, North Lanarkshire Council has been awarded significant funding through the Schools for the Future programme and also through the Learning Estate and Investment programme. And of course, that has been as a result of the direct request from North Lanarkshire Council to prioritise that school in North Lanarkshire. However, of course, the capital challenges the government faces at the current time are well known to the member. He alludes to the cut, of course, coming from the UK government, and that is undoubtedly impacting on the funding from this government. We are protecting local government funding within that context, and I look forward to continuing to work with the Scottish Futures Trust on improving the remainder of Scotland's school estate. And it's worthwhile pointing out, Presiding Officer, that since 2007, the quality of Scotland's school estate has improved from around about 60% of Scotland's schools being good or satisfactory condition to over 90%, thanks to investment from this SNP Scottish Government.
Gordon MacDonald.
The SNP's record of investment in our school estate speaks for itself, but can I ask the Cabinet Secretary how much Labour's legacy of PFI is costing in North Lanarkshire?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, North Lanarkshire Council's PFI schools contract was signed back in 2005, and the associated estimated payments total around about £764 million, with £430 million of that still to be paid out. So 17 years after they were last in government in Scotland, Labour's PFI legacy is still holding Scotland back. And it means we have less money to spend on frontline services for Scotland's children. That is a shameful record, and Labour members in this chamber should be embarrassed, Presiding Officer.
I call Megan Gallagher.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Parents of ASN pupils protested outside North Lanarkshire Council last year. They said that teachers and pupils are being failed by an education system that does not recognise the specialised skills needed for children with additional support needs. Many school-aged children end up being placed in mainstream educational schools, despite meeting criteria for an ASN school due to the lack of schools available. So what is the Minister's response to the many families in North Lanarkshire being failed by the education system due to the lack of specialised schools and facilities for ASN pupils?
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank the member for her question. Of course, it's worthwhile putting on the record that we are seeing record levels of investment in additional support needs pupils through pupil support assistance. That's because of ring-fence funding coming directly from the Scottish Government. The Government also ring-fences £50 million worth of funding to protect additional support needs support in our schools. But in general, of course, as I alluded to in the response to the original question, the school estate is the responsibility of local authorities. We work with local authorities where we are able to do so and to prioritise the needs of additional support these pupils, and it is worthwhile saying that some of the funding that we announced back at the end of last year is going to improving the school estate in for additional support needs pupils.
Question number three is not lodged. Question number four, Sue Webber.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what plans it has for any major rail development projects beyond the end of 2024.
Cabinet Secretary Fiona Hislop.
Scottish ministers remain firmly committed to infrastructure investment as a key factor in securing economic growth and high-quality public infrastructure across Scotland. That has been made much harder due to cuts in our capital budget imposed by the UK Government. The Scottish Government's investment in Network Rail's operations, maintenance and renewals for Scotland's railway will increase by £0.45 billion from £3.75 billion in the 2019-24 period to £4.2 billion throughout 2024-29. We continue to progress a pipeline of enhancement projects, and the member may particularly note the planned electrification of the line from Glasgow to East Kilbride, which is targeted to be delivered by December 2025.
Sue Webber.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for her response and outlining some of the pipeline developments that are coming forward. But she will be aware that residents of Winchborough are weary of the continued shirking of responsibility by the SNP Green Government to build a train station in their town. On the 8th of March, the Minister, Jim Fairley, wrote to me that his understanding is that West Lothian Council is responsible for organisation and invitations for the multi-stakeholder meeting. However, West Lothian Council first wrote to the Scottish Government in June 2023, and it was only yesterday they received a response committing to a date for this meeting. Given that Winchborough train station isn't developer-led, the Scottish Government and Transport Scotland must take charge and lead on this. Cabinet Secretary, now that the Minister has agreed to the meeting, can you assure us that building this station will be a priority for this Government?
Cabinet Secretary.
As the member well knows, I am the constituency MSP for Winchborough, and in that constituency capacity, I have long campaigned for a station which was always to be developer-led. To avoid a conflict of interest, I am recused from having any involvement in government interests on this matter, but I can still act and will still act on such issues as the constituency MSP. As such, I will ask the lead minister to write to the member to address her concerns as is appropriate, and the point about the meeting, if she's had a reply to that, I'm glad to see that progress.
Brief supplementary, Kenneth Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Does the Cabinet Secretary believe that the London to Birmingham High Speed Rail 2 project, now expected to cost an eye-watering £583 million per mile, benefits Scotland in any way whatsoever, and if so, how?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, since 2009, this Scottish Government have reconnected 16 communities to the rail network with new stations and two more stations planned to open this year. But the eye-watering HS2 curtailed project will have limited, if any, benefit to Scotland, and the collapse in capital spend elsewhere by the Westminster Government harms the economy and harms Scotland.
Brief supplementary, Craig Hoy.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Minister will be aware that East Lothian is one of the fastest growing areas in Scotland and that Haddington is one of the fastest growing towns locally. The Rail Action Group of East Scotland is campaigning for the reopening of Haddington's branch line. Will she agree to look carefully at this campaign and their calls and look to get Haddington back on track onto our rail network?
Cabinet Secretary.
I'm aware of the campaign in Haddington, and I know the member and also the constituency MSP Paul McLennan have pursued that issue. I think it's really important to address the interests of communities. It can take some time, as we are aware, to develop such plans, but clearly I will ask my officials to look and be aware of the Haddington developments along with colleagues at Network Rail and ScotRail.
Brief supplementary, Willie Rennie.
The Cabinet Secretary told me last November, the 2nd of November, that we'd get a response to the Newborough Stag transport appraisal in a few weeks' time. It's now months later. When are they going to hear about their success in Newborough?
Cabinet Secretary.
So my officials at Transport Scotland have met with Sestran and representatives of their consultants and the Newborough Train Station Group on the 16th of January to discuss the Newborough Detailed Options Appraisal Report for that transport appraisal. This appraisal is considering a range of multimodal transport options, including a station at Newborough. They have requested further information underpinning the detail presented within the report, and once that additional information requested from Sestran, the promoter of the appraisal has been received and considered, Transport Scotland's official will provide feedback on the appraisal report.
Question number five, Brian Whittle.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what action it's taking to ensure that Scotland's further education sector is aligned with the needs of businesses within the renewable sector and other industries associated with the green economy.
Minister Graham Day.
Presiding Officer, our education and skills system is already adapting to this transition to net zero, and institutions like colleges are key anchors. Funded by the SFC Energy Skills Partnership, act as the college sector lead for the transition to net zero and directly supports institutions to develop their capability, capacity and curriculum pathways for the transition. ESP also engages with employers on behalf of the sector, establishing partnerships across the further education sector and industry to enable the green economy.
Brian Whittle.
Can I thank the Minister for that answer? This week I visited, for Apprenticeship Week last week, I visited electrical engineers in Kilmarnock, Aird, Walker and Rolston. And they said that their sluggish lack of growth is actually a problem because they struggle to recruit the appropriate apprentices. and they say the biggest problem is that school pupils are unaware of potential careers through apprenticeships like electrical engineering. Colleges have the capacity to deliver the engineers we need for the green economy. It seems there is a missing link between schools, business and colleges. So can I ask us what the Scottish Government can do to ensure that career guidance includes the opportunities that apprenticeships can bring in the growing green economy?
Minister.
Senator Officer, Brian Whittle raises a really relevant point. Promotion of green skills as career options for young people is incredibly important. I was at NESCO in Aberdeen on Monday where we were discussing just that issue, ensuring that young people are encouraged to consider energy and other such careers as long-term career opportunities. The Career Service absolutely has a role to play in that, of course it does, but I think alongside employers, working in conjunction with employers, perhaps offering work experience opportunities, as well as working with the colleges to shape the curriculums. I'm happy to engage further with Brian Whittle on that matter.
Question number 6 has been withdrawn. Question number 7, Colin Smith.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, to ask the Scottish Government what action it has taken to improve the accessibility for disabled people at train stations in Dumfries and Galloway.
Cabinet Secretary.
Dumfries Station is currently being upgraded with a new footbridge and lifts to make access to the platforms easier. Whilst the accessibility of stations is a matter reserved to the UK Government, the Scottish Government is fully supportive of and engaged with this project. My officials are independently progressing Recommendation 19 of the Strategic Transport Projects Review 2, reviewing station accessibility across Scotland, including in Dumfries and Galloway. The review is anticipated to complete in spring 2024, and whilst it is too early to comment on any outcome to the review, Recommendation 19 reinforces the Scottish Government's commitment to improve access for all to Scotland's rail network.
Colin Smith.
Thank you, President. No, sir. Even after the work at Dumfries Station, almost half of the stations in the region will still not be fully accessible. Kirkconnell Station in particular has no disabled access whatsoever to the southbound platform. It means my constituent, who is in a wheelchair, had to travel and stay on the train from Glasgow to Sankar, then change at Sankar and get a train back to Kirkconnell northbound because he couldn't get off the train at Kirkconnell. Now, we've had feasibility studies on what's needed to end this discrimination against disabled people, but what my constituent wants to know is when will we see action to see Kirkconnell Station fully accessible?
Cabinet Secretary.
So as I set out in my original answer, this is reserved to the UK Government, and the DfT are undertaking that detailed accessibility audit. I appreciate his frustration. I think he sets out the concerns of his constituent very well, and I will do what I can within my powers to ensure that once that audit has been completed, that the identification of the work and the priorities is progressed.
Question number 8, Neil Bibby.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what its position is on the creation of a national online support platform to expand music learning for children and young people in Scotland.
Cabinet Secretary Jenny Gilruth.
This Government has transformed instrumental music tuition in Scotland schools by funding councils to eradicate unfair music tuition charges. This financial year we are providing £12 million to continue this commitment. The most recent instrumental music survey, published in December of last year, shows that the number of pupils participating in instrumental music tuition is at a record high since the survey began 11 years ago. Since 2007, we have invested over £150 million in the Youth Music Initiative, helping young people across Scotland to access music and develop their wider skills and learning. And schools across Scotland today already have access to the national e-learning offer, supported by £1.5 million of investment from the Scottish Government. And this includes a range of online learning materials, recorded lessons and live lessons on music.
Neil Bibby.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. Music and the arts should be for everyone, and it's clear we need to do far more to create opportunities for working class children. In Wales, the National Music Service, working with Chiranga, has developed a national bespoke online support platform to not replace existing instrumental tuition, but to help non-music specialist teachers to expand music learning in schools. For a relatively small cost, we could make that transformative change here in Scotland too. So can I ask the Minister, would she agree to meet with me to discuss and explore that proposal?
Cabinet Secretary.
I'm happy to meet with the member to listen to any contributions he might have in this space, but I would just put on the record, Presiding Officer, as Education Scotland have already advised, What is being proposed, as I understand it, from Welsh Labour, is very similar to the current offer that we have nationally in relation to the online ELO platform and also on Glo. That's available to all local authority areas in Scotland. But I'm more than happy to meet with the member on this. And it is worth putting on the record, of course, it was the SNP in government who removed fees for instrumental music tuition, making it free to all pupils. And I would remind the member that the reason we had to do so was because some councils, including Labour-run councils, decided to introduce charges, seeing parents build up to £300 per year.